it's been a rough couple of days for the United States. We've had basically back-to-back mass shootings in Dayton, Ohio, and El Paso, Texas. If you are in any of those areas, I hope that everyone's okay. I hope that you're with your loved ones. I hope that you're safe. And, you know, even for people who are outside of those areas, stay vigilant, be safe. And really, there are really no words to describe this kind of tragedy, because when this type of thing happens, you know, thoughts and prayers can only go so far. So I really want to talk about more of the psychology of mass shooters, because, you know, there's a lot of misconceptions about mass shooters always being mentally ill, and that's just not the case. Psychosis is actually rare. I mean, there are cases where mass shooters have been in some sort of psychosis or have had a mental illness, but in the majority of cases, it's deliberately planned out. There's some sort of agenda, some sort of hatred, you know, whether it's misogyny, whether it's racism, whether it's white supremacy. You know, there's just a lot of hateful, malicious things. There's just a lot of planning that goes into it when it comes to narcissistic mass shooters. And experts have actually talked about the link between malignant narcissism and these mass shootings. So I do want to get into it. And I know some of you are going to preemptively say, well, shouldn't we be talking about gun control and laws that regulate gun control? Yes, that is a major part of the problem, and I invite you to add on to that discussion. But for right now, this video is going to focus on the connection between malignant narcissism and mass shooters. I do agree that, you know, gun regulations and laws are a huge problem in the United States, and it's probably a huge chunk of what makes this type of violence so accessible to narcissistic mass shooters like this. So we do have to address that as well. However, I do think that discussing the psychology of mass shooters can help to add to the discussion in a different way, because to understand what enables these shooters to really go out in society and cause harm even before they cause this massive destruction, right? So a lot of you may have heard this research and the studies and experts who talk about the fact that mass shooters tend to have a history of domestic violence. And so really it begins in their own homes, within their own intimate relationships, right? And it probably doesn't surprise any one of us who has ever experienced a malignant narcissist, because we do know how they behave. We do know that they lack empathy, that they're exploitative, that they might even lack remorse at times. And in the most extreme case, they may even lack a conscience. So we really have to be vigilant about the fact that, you know, these types of predators really start their violence at home. They start their violence at home. There has been associations with online trolling, for example, and psychopathy and Machiavellianism and narcissism and mass shooters, right? Mass shooters often have this history of online trolling and cyberbullying, and they incite a lot of hate speech against minorities or women. And so there's usually an online trail of them creating this kind of manifesto even before they give that manifesto for their mass violence. So we have to remember this. The people who you think are just trolling online, they could likely escalate into violence. They could likely do great harm one day. And they probably are honestly doing great harm already, not just to the people they bully online, but to real life partners, their real life family members, their real life friends. So really understanding these associations, that this kind of mass violence doesn't just pop out of nowhere. It's been there for a very long time with these types of predators. And we know this because there have been studies, there have been experts, there has been research that shows that link between malignant narcissism, its associated behaviors, its traits, and mass shooters. For example, another study showed that male narcissists, now of course female narcissists exist as well, but this study observed male narcissists, and it showed that male narcissists tend to have hatred towards heterosexual women more so than any other group. So that kind of misogyny can be a telltale sign that someone does have narcissistic traits. And it's no surprise that a lot of these mass shooters also have a history of misogyny, have a history of domestic violence, along with that history of online bullying and trolling and inciting hate speech on forums and across social media. So taking into account all of these associations, I wanted to point to some specific studies and articles and experts you can look at to see this connection even more vividly. I will also post an image that I created, a little chart that tracks kind of the web, the network of these associations as well, so you can see it in a more tangible manner. But I will be quoting some of these articles that I'm going to be leaving the link to in the description box below. So let's start with Brad J. Bushman's research article, which is called Narcissism, Fame Seeking, and Mass Shootings. Okay, so I'm going to be reading out the abstract because you can access the full article on the website if you want to, you know, pay for it, or through your own kind of college or university, you can access it there as well. So the abstract says, for many years, the conventional wisdom was that most acts of aggression and violence stem from insecurities and low self-esteem. The possibility that some mass shooters have low self-esteem, low self-worth, or painful personal insecurities should not lead us to overlook another more likely possibility, that a significant number of mass shooters may have large egos and narcissistic tendencies. This article will A, describe the psychological concepts of narcissism and narcissistic traits, B, review previous research on links between narcissism, aggression, and violence, C, review evidence that some mass shooters exhibit narcissistic traits, and D, discuss the implications of narcissistic mass shooters for society and the media coverage of their shooting rampages. So you may have heard that, you may have heard the suggestion that you should not name a mass shooter as soon as this happens, because not only can it potentially create copycat crimes with these types of shooters being kind of glorified in the media, even if it's in a disparaging way, they still get their 10 seconds of fame. So you're giving them that grandiosity that they're seeking. You're giving them that fame, right? And according to this article, some mass shooters do have that narcissistic grandiosity, and they do act out of that need for attention, for power and control. And behind this mass violence is that lack of empathy. It's that callous lack of regard for human life. And it's the ability to take lives without blinking. And it's the ability to even take your own life, because that's how you think that you can gain power in your life. Because that's what you think you're entitled to. You think you're entitled to take a human life in order to assert your own kind of dominance, or to feed this kind of persecutory delusion of being victimized. Because a lot of these narcissists who engage in these mass shootings and engage in these cruel, callous acts of violence, of hideous, unbridled violence, they have these delusions of persecution. They have this kind of paranoia that comes with malignant narcissism along with antisocial traits. They truly believe in some sense that they can be God, and that they are the victims of society that does not recognize their godliness or their superiority. So realizing that that's their mentality, that it is deliberate, it is malicious, and even though it stems from paranoia, they are not in psychosis, they are not having an hallucination. They know exactly what they're doing, they know the consequences, they know that they're taking innocent lives, but they just don't care. And it's all to fulfill that agenda, whatever agenda they think they have, whether it's ridding the United States of immigrants, or ridding the United States of so-called invaders, or ridding the United States of, you know, people of color, minorities, women, whether it's, you know, fighting against, you know, the rise of feminism, or whatever kind of bullshit that they subscribe to, it all goes along with this network of malignant narcissism. And that's how it all connects, you know, the misogyny, the domestic violence, the online bullying, the trolling, the constant the constant search for more fame, more attention, the inability to regard human life as precious, to the inability to distinguish between, you know, an innocent victim and someone who you think has wronged you. And these people think that they've been wronged, but they really haven't. I'm not saying they have experienced adversity in their lives, but who hasn't? And a lot of us have experienced even more adversity than some of these shooters, and we have not taken the lives of innocent victims. But we have not taken the lives of innocent victims like this. So we really have to steer away from this commentary of like, oh, they must have low self-esteem, they were bullied, they were this, they were that. Well, you know, a lot of us have been bullied. A lot of us have been told cruel, heinous things. We have been abused, we have been assaulted, we have been God knows what, and none of us have taken human lives. None of us have taken innocent human lives. So there's no justification for abuse like that. There's no justification for massive mass violence like that. If you have issues with people who have bullied you or abused you, there are other ways to gain justice legally. There are other ways to, you know, channel that productively and pave a new path for yourself and pave your path to success. There's many disenfranchised, marginalized people in the world, especially a lot of people of color and, you know, disenfranchised women who have been marginalized their entire lives, and they have not taken any innocent lives. So that is not a justification, okay? And I think this article puts it into perspective because we realize that the intentions are not about lashing out in pain. It's about lashing out in this false sense of aggression and superiority. It's about lashing out thinking that you are God and that you are entitled to take these lives. So the next one is about the California shooter. And usually I wouldn't mention his name. I wouldn't mention this shooter's name, but it's already out in the press. So I'm just going to call him by his name once, Elliot Roger. And he was the one with the, you know, huge manifesto about how women ignored him and rejected him. And he was kind of the forerunner of the incel movement of people who think they're entitled to sex from women. And if they don't get it, then they can retaliate. So a lot of people thought that Elliot Roger had some sort of autism. And this article refutes that fact. This article is written by a person with a PhD. I'm sorry if I'm mispronouncing his name. It's Enrico Ganalti. I hope I've pronounced that name correctly. If I haven't, I'm very sorry. But he does discuss Malignant Narcissism and Elliot Roger. And one of the excerpts that I found most interesting was when he says that close to the beginning of Elliot Roger's manifesto, he confesses that jealousy and envy, those are the two feelings that would dominate my entire life and bring me immense pain. The feelings of jealousy I felt at 9 years old were frustrating, but they were nothing compared to how I would feel once I hit puberty and had to watch girls choosing other boys over me. Any problem I had at 9 years old was nirvana compared to what I was doomed to face. Roger's envy was far beyond the outskirts of normal. It was not the sort of benign envy where a person is motivated to take active steps to procure life advantages and personal qualities others have that he or she also wishes to possess. It was malignant envy, the sort involving feeling superior to others and perfectly justified in showing contempt towards them for having life advantages and personal qualities one feels entitled to but does not possess. Others' apparent material wealth, their popularity, their social ease, their active sex life were a constant source of resentment for Roger. Over time, his desire to spoil others' successes in these areas evolved into a full-blown megalomaniacal effort to assault and kill others whom he believed possessed the goods that he was entitled to but felt deprived of. He admitted to his vengeful envy at a Katy Perry concert where he ogled those around him. I couldn't help, he says, but feel a bitter form of envy at all the rich kids at the concert. I would take great pleasure in watching those rich families burn alive. Now, when you think about this and you think about the research that's been done, I recently actually wrote an article, I wrote two articles that talks about the connection between malignant narcissism and malicious envy, because there is actually research that connects the two and says those who are part of the dark triad who have traits like narcissism, psychopathy, and Machiavellianism, they tend to have a lot of malicious envy where they try to sabotage others. They're not happy for other people's success. So this has been proven by research, guys. It's not even just our experiences or even just the DSM-5, which says that narcissists are envious of others and believe others to be envious of them. It's actually proven by research and studies that have studied narcissism and the dark triad. And Elliot Rodger had a lot of that. He had a lot of that pathological, malicious, malignant envy that malignant narcissists have. Now, it's more likely that he had a narcissistic personality disorder because he described himself as such a god. He had these grandiose delusions than any other disorder, in my opinion. And you can read a lot of articles about this and how it talks about how Elliot Rodger most likely suffered from narcissism. And I don't want to use the word suffer, but yeah, he had narcissism. It's, you know, rather than autism or any other disorder that they might be talking about. Another article that I wanted to quote was Jean Kim, MD's article. And this one is called American Narcissism and Mass Shooters. And again, guys, I will be leaving the links to these articles so you can read them in depth below in the description box. And Jean Kim, MD, writes, with the recent discussion on mental health and mass shootings, people have not adequately distinguished between what psychological conditions give rise to a mass murderer. There is a general tendency to simplify it as some general mental illness, and many pro-gun activists are quick to use that as an excuse to deflect attention from the gun issue. Unfortunately, desperate mental health activists are also happy to use this misguided attention to advocate for badly needed funding for community mental health causes, although it's ultimately a self-undermining tactic. It's easy to blame mental illness, as people are understandably horrified at the impulse to shoot random people. Although to me, it is more a function of not terribly uncommon impulse, more easily brought to fruition by access to guns. But I am not here to discuss the gun issue, more the psychology behind American narcissism and its toxic fulfillment in the form of the mass shooter. As a few recent articles and TV host John Oliver noted, true clinical psychiatric illness does not often correlate with mass shootings. I would argue that perhaps the Aurora, Colorado shooter appeared to have a pure psychotic illness with associated delusions that fueled his rampage, but most of the rest of the recent perpetrators and had more of an issue with malignant narcissism. So we really have to be wary of this, of calling mass shooters mentally ill, because malignant narcissism, even though it's considered, you know, part of these mental health conditions and it's part of psychopathology, it is not part of what we traditionally see as mental illness, because people who suffer from mental illness usually suffer, and they are either not in control of themselves in some way, or they're just suffering so much and it's debilitating to them. Whereas malignant narcissists, they know what they're doing. They're perfectly aware of what they're doing. They're not in psychosis. There's a great quote by Robert Hare in Without Conscience. And actually, I'm going to pull that up because I think that it describes it perfectly. So So Robert Hare writes in his book, Without Conscience, The Disturbing World of Psychopaths Among Us, he writes, most clinicians and researchers don't use the term psychopath in that way. They know that psychopathy cannot be understood in terms of traditional views of mental illness. Psychopaths are not disoriented or out of touch with reality, nor do they experience the delusions, the hallucinations, or the intense subjective distress that characterize most other mental disorders. Unlike psychotic individuals, psychopaths are rational and aware of what they are doing and why. Their behavior is the result of choice freely exercised. So this is so important to remember when we think about mental illness and we think about mass shootings and malignant narcissism. When we call someone a malignant narcissist, we're not saying they're mentally ill. We're saying that they have a character disorder. I love this term, character disorder. I borrowed it from Dr. George Simon, who wrote In Sheep's Clothing. And he writes that narcissism becomes particularly malignant when it goes beyond mere vanity and self-focus, right? Malignant narcissists not only see themselves as superior to others, believe in their superiority to the degree that they view others as relatively worthless, expendable, and justifiably exploitable. This type of narcissism is a defining characteristic of psychopathy, sociopathy, and is rooted in an individual deficient capacity for empathy. It's almost impossible for a person with such shallow feelings and such haughtiness to really care about others, to form a conscience with any of the qualities we typically associate with a humane attitude. Which is why most researchers and thinkers in the topic of psychopathy think of psychopaths as individuals without a conscience altogether. So when we realize that it's not like a person who is struggling with this crippling anxiety or depression. It's not someone who's overwhelmed by their conscience. It's someone who possesses no conscience. It's someone who thinks so little of the value and worth of other human lives that they are willing to basically destroy them. They are willing to sabotage out of envy. They are willing to destroy lives, to ruin lives, to take lives, to rob lives forever. And that is the exact mentality of some of the recent mass shooters that we've seen recently. And I have written an in-depth article going into some specific cases. So if you are interested in reading that, I will leave a link to that as well below. But I did want to quote one more article, and this is by Dr. Winston Chung, a psychiatrist at the Sutter Pacific Medical Foundation. And he says, while the motives behind the mass shootings in the US over the past 15 years may vary, there is one common theme linking the shooters at Columbine, Virginia Tech, Santa Barbara, and possibly Seattle: narcissistic rage from narcissistic wounds. Narcissistic rage is describing the narcissist as having a fragile sense of self that is oversensitive to perceived rejection or slights, sometimes resulting in uncontrolled, violent rage. And he quotes the Santa Barbara shooter's words, which reveal, he says, an entitled and envious self as a victim. Quote, humanity struck me at first by condemning me to experience so much suffering, leading him to seek revenge on all the hedonistic scum who enjoyed lives of pleasures they don't deserve. If I can't have it, I will destroy it. And guys, I mean that is the tagline for narcissism. If I can't have it, I will destroy it. I will covet it. I will sabotage you. I may pretend to be happy for you, but I will destroy it. So when you think about all of these experts and all these articles and all this research and studies that show these links, these associations with malignant narcissism, its associated behavior such as committing domestic violence, online bullying and trolling, misogyny and racism, hatred towards women. When you think about all that and it's connected to these mass shooters and their entitlement, their excessive sense of entitlement, their lack of empathy for others, their lack of conscience, their ability to see human life as expendable, we realize that mental illness is not the problem here. It's the character disorder. It's malignant narcissism. It's the fact that we don't hold these abusers and bullies accountable the first time they abuse. And what do I mean by the first time they abuse? I mean the fact that, you know, a police officer may not arrest a domestic abuser, or may not take a stalker or someone who's harassing someone seriously enough. And so that never goes on their record. And then they gain access to guns. And then they shoot up, you know, this just a bar or a yoga studio, or they kill innocent victims. And this is not new to them, because they have harmed in the past. They have, you know, abused people behind closed doors, the victims who never got help. I mean, there's been victims of stalking and harassment who later got killed by their partners. And in a lot of mass shootings, actually, the mass shooter does kill their former partner along with these innocent victims too. So there has been cases of that as well. So we need to tackle and hold accountable these abusers when they first begin offending, and we need to take it seriously. You know, an online troll, for example, who incites hate speech against minorities or women, or, you know, has a history of serially attacking and bullying and harassing people online. I mean, guys, when I first started out and I had these two viral articles, I mean, I encountered some of the most vicious cyberbullies, and I have no doubt that those are the same types of people who are mass shooters, who are malignant narcissists, because they literally had thousands of comments on different articles where they were serially bullying, harassing, and inciting hate speech against these often women writers. And so we have to think about that. Misogyny is part of it. A history of domestic violence is a part of it. Online bullying is a part of it. If you see people who are inciting hate speech, who are targeting minorities, who are targeting women, who are engaging in violent threats, who are engaging in stalking and harassment, take that seriously, whether you're in law enforcement, whether you are a loved one or a friend of someone who is surviving this. Take it seriously the first time around so this doesn't happen. And educate people on these disorders so that they understand that it's not just low self-esteem. It's not just a bad childhood, because a lot of us have horrible childhoods. A lot of us have survived and thrived through some of the worst moments of our lives. And we have taken that and we have channeled into something greater. And these people choose to abuse. They choose to continue the abuse cycle. Whatever they experience in this life, it does not entitle them to take innocent lives like this. So we really have to understand that, and we really have to take into account the true psychology of mass shooters. And I'm not saying that every single mass shooter is a malignant narcissist. Of course, there are cases where they really were suffering from a mental illness, or there was another type of agenda, but we just have to understand that into account. We have to take into account the fact that, yes, it may just be that they have no conscience and they simply don't care. I mean, there was even one mass shooter who was quoted as saying, "I was bored, so why not? Why not?" He said, "I was bored and why not?" And we know from Robert Hare, Dr. Robert Hare talks about how psychopaths are prone to boredom. So he just wanted to escape his boredom. And so he shot up a bar filled with innocent victims, and he didn't stop. And most of these are pre-calculated, premeditated. And there are experts who say one of the most predictive traits of a mass shooter is narcissism combined with some sort of paranoia. So basically malignant narcissism. And by paranoia, I don't mean that they're having delusions. I just mean that they feel like they're being victimized and persecuted, like Elliot Rodger felt when he wasn't getting the attention he thought he deserved from other women. And when he saw all of these people with higher status, or, you know, a better bank account, living their lives, you know, to a normal person, it may anger them, but he took it to the level of the sheer type of entitlement that only a malignant narcissist could take it. And as a result, he took innocent lives. And as a result, those families will never be the same. And as a result, you know, people who could have accomplished their dreams and made a difference in the world are no longer here. So just think about that. Just think about how one person's conscienceless behavior affects so many in one lifetime. I mean, it's disturbing, it's callous, it's cruel, and it's inhumane, and we need to continue speaking out about it. We need to continue advocating for victims. We need to continue spreading awareness, and we need to continue trying to hold these people accountable for their crimes before they escalate into this kind of massive violence, right? It starts at home, usually. They're usually starting by abusing their most intimate loved ones. So start there, start there. So I hope this video has helped. If you have any thoughts about, you know, the mass shootings, the psychology of mass shooters, gun violence, anything you want to add to this video, please feel free to do so below. I'll talk to you guys soon, and until next time, take care.